Welcome to Investing Insights, partnered by Right Property Group. This is your host, Phil Tarrant.
Oh, g'day everyone, it's Phil Tarrant here. Thanks for joining us on our next instalment of Investing Insights with the Right Property Group. I have my regular co-hosts in the podcast studio, Steve Waters and Victor Kumar. How are you going, guys?
Yeah, well, mate, how are you? Thanks.
The market. How do you feel about the market, Steve? We talk pretty much every other day, it feels like. I speak to you more at the moment than my wife, and that concerns me and alarms me.
Like, why don't you just put that out there a little further, huh?
I know. But this is what a good buyer's agent does, keeps connected and communicated. But, we're buying at the moment through you guys, and we often speak about the market, and markets are changing, and we're in an interesting cycle, part of the cycle right now, where some markets are good, some markets are bad, some markets are indifferent. Perth coming back, I'm led to believe.
According to the media.
Yep. Fake news.
Possibly.
Perhaps.
Yeah.
Sydney's done and dusted. Brisbane's the place to be, allegedly. Parts of. And I'm still reading stories about the crisis of Australian debt, where every Australian owes $2 for every dollar they make every single year. So it's doom and gloom and the sky's falling in.
Scary numbers, right? Yeah. Look, I think the market's, not much has changed in the market other than the obvious regions of oversupply, which we've all been banging on about for the last 18 months, and they've now come to fruition. I think the big key to the market at the moment is all around finance. If we take the obvious, you know, fundamentals away and what have you, finance is the driving factor here. The lack of serviceability, perhaps, for some investors, being able to perpetuate into the next property, or whether it be to release equity, whatever it is. And what we also find is with the increasing interest rates and the rising prices, we have that double effect of lowering yields or cash flow, which is essentially what enables us to hold on to the property. Having said all of that, there are some good markets still in metropolitan areas around Australia that are showing yields of 6 to 7% gross, of course. And when the cost of your money is what now, average about 5%, if we're going to be a little negative or conservative, 5% is still cheap money. The biggest thing that we see in the media at the moment, and perhaps with the unsophisticated investor, is that the panic is around rising interest rates. But let's be fair here. It was only 2 years ago or thereabouts that we'd group hug high five if we got 5% or 4.99. Now that we're back at that because we were used to 4.1 and what have you, there's a little bit of panic there. And for us, it's still cheap money. On a long-term average, 5% is still cheap money.
Good.
Yeah.
So the question for you, Victor, is it a good time to be investing in property?
Look, yes and no. If you are right on the line, red line, in terms of servicing the loan, so you're pushing yourself to get into a property and you're relying on the interest rates to be stable, the rents to be consistent, for you to be able to hold onto the property, and the lender that you've chosen is the only lender you could ever qualify with, I think you should take some time out. But in these sorts of markets, that's when the bargains start coming out. That's when there's a lot more flexibility in terms of what you can negotiate. For someone that's better prepared and well connected, this is the market to invest in.
Well, that's the key, isn't it? Being well prepared, even if you're in that consolidation phase, you still want to be prepared for the what ifs, and just in case you need to pounce. What was interesting, I saw on the news the other day that there's zero 400,000 and below
in Sydney
properties in the Sydney Basin, which I find amazing because it's been rapid growth, and I think there'll be a period of very little growth so that we can get those averages, so to speak. But I still think it's amazing that it wasn't too long ago. Well, if we even take your property, Phil, say one of the Mount Druitt units, what was that, 200,000 or 180 or something like that? And look at it now. It's actually one of those very few properties under 400,000.
Yeah, but it goes back to time in the market rather than time in the market. But it's not what I want to chat to you guys today about. I want to, I guess I've bookended my comments to you guys around the market, because property investment is a game of time rather than a game of chance.
So very deep, Phil.
It is. And I can get deep. I can get in touch with my deeper side, and I've just come off the back of a surf trip, so I'm really got
back
my
in touch
sort
with
of
nature.
Yin and yang sorted out at the moment. I'm thinking with a lot more clarity. But we're going through a period of growth in our portfolio after a bit of a hiatus, and you can listen to it on the Smart Property Investment Show where I chat to Steve about it. But I've been thinking a lot about managing my portfolio lately, and we sort of touched on some previous podcasts about and to your point, and this is something that I've always sort of thought you've explained well, is that a lot of people get carried away thinking that property is a passive investment. You guys are the first to say, hang on a second, property is not a passive investment. Mm. If you really want to grow, if you want to create wealth through property, you need to be hands-on. So managing your portfolio is critical for anyone who wants to build a portfolio of multiple properties. And a lot of people, I think, when they think about managing their portfolio, they think about property managers and making sure the hot water system's working, or, you know, I've got to replace some locks or whatever. Managing your portfolio is something very different, isn't it?
Far more than that. Far more than that. And I think, just coming back to the comment where property's not passive, I think the only passive part of property is probably its growth. And that's, of course, if you don't do the renovations and, you know, force equity. That, I suppose, could be passive, but certainly the cash flow management is not. That's where it's a hands-on approach and you've got to be involved. And that's everywhere from, as you mentioned, Phil, managing your property manager, because they have a role to play, through to insurance, through to your brokers or your financiers. There's a lot involved. And you know, you'll hear, I think Victor likes to sit down on a Sunday night because he's got nothing else better to do and plan out his next
the
week's
property weirdo.
I know, right? and he adjusts his cash flow there, whereas I'm probably not that pedantic. I like to do it every month, but I suppose that's because we're in the market every day doing everybody else's reviews and management.
So on that basis then, and I'm one of the probably the biggest advocates of surrounding yourself with people who can do stuff better than yourself. And, you know, I use you guys to buy my properties, and I've got a good broker and a good accountant. I look to outsource part of the management of my portfolio because the people I work with are good at what they do and I don't have a lot of time. But you would always fundamentally say back to me, you're responsible for managing your portfolio. You
100%.
Can't expect other people to manage it. So let's touch on that quickly. Do you think a lot of people get that wrong? They think that someone else's job if I pay them?
Yeah, probably the biggest example of that would be a property manager. Yeah, you pay your 7 or 8% and you expect stuff to be done and be done on time and that you don't have to remind them. But you need to understand that property management is, if not the hardest, it'd be the second hardest job in terms of property. And so they are constantly busy. And they rely upon a lot of systems and procedures and also...
Ever-changing goalposts.
Yeah, and rules and regulations. Mm. So some things do get missed and they require a lot of direction from the landlord. But unfortunately, sometimes landlords just think, well, you know, I'm paying them, you make that decision. And a really good example of that would be they find a new tenant for you and they've vet checked them, so to speak, and done the P&L or the assets and liabilities. But 99% of the time, the property manager will come back to you as a landlord and say the decision is yours. And that's where you need to be involved. You need to be involved in the increase or the decrease of your rent.
So should you be prompting the property management to do that, or they should be coming to you to do it?
Well, look, yeah, in a theoretical world, no, you should wait for them to come to you because, yeah, that's what they do. They're in the market every day. But I think that's a bit of a cop-out. If you want to be invested in your own business, then you should be monitoring it on a monthly basis at the very least to see what the market's doing, not just in terms of value, but in terms of cash flow being the rent. And you know, if you haven't got enough time to talk to your property managers, well then, you know, more fool you.
Victor, how do you know if you're not managing your portfolio very well?
Well, the first thing is if you start losing sight of the numbers, in other words, you know, what your property is rented for, you know, whether the tenant is up to date, where your interest rates are at, all that sort of stuff, then you start to lose control of the portfolio because then you're flying blind. Yeah, so that's one of the things that I find quite common is that when you talk to most investors and you ask them what their interest rates are or what rent they're getting, they're probably quoting something that's 3, 4, maybe 6 months old in terms of the information. If you got that wrong, then it starts unraveling, and it starts unraveling rather rapidly, especially in this market that's changing where you would want to keep a tenant on, if that's a good paying tenant, because your rents are starting to ease out a bit because of where the market is right now. It's purely a cyclical thing. So if you lost a tenant today, there's likelihood that you'd be, depending on the area, depending on the condition of the property and so forth, and depending on how good the property manager is and how proactive they are, that you would be vacant for 2-3 weeks. And it could be all prevented if you had a finger on the pulse. And if the tenant had asked for something mundane, you actually granted that, but not getting into a habit of granting everything that the tenant asked for.
Yeah, I think the problem is that people get lost within their own portfolios. Those that do take notice, I suppose, or are involved, you get lost because you're always looking at your own figures. And it really does pay dividends to get someone outside of that to dig in there for you. And a really good example is, yeah, I'll look at Victor's portfolio, he'll look at mine, and then we start to tweak and give advice on each other's portfolio, even though that's what we do every day.
Yeah.
But more amazing is how many people actually don't review their scenario or their position. on a constant basis. And I'm not even talking annually. I'm talking a couple of times a year.
See, I'd put my hands up and say, what you were just talking about, Victor, I sometimes feel like I fall into that boat, right?
It's hard to catch up once you've let it go.
It's hard to catch up. And I generally need a bit of a prompt to get back in there and sort it out. And you've just done that for me. So I've got to, you know. I know our portfolio is fine, right? It's cool. And there's mechanisms for it to keep doing what it's doing, right? But, you know, if you put a gun against my head and said, what's your rent on all your different properties, I probably couldn't tell you. Mm. You know, I'd probably thereabouts know.
Yeah.
And I'm always first say, you got to know your numbers, right? I should know, you know, how much all my properties are, whether or not they've got tenants in there, you know.
That's always a good start.
It is. Yeah. You know? And to be fair, I've 2 weeks later and I've not known that one of them was vacant. I'm going, well, what's going on? Like, but whose fault is that? It's my fault.
It's your fault.
Yeah, it's my fault.
Doesn't matter whether the property manager has told you or not, you should have noticed that there's no income coming in. And this is one of the things that that we encourage all our clients to do. We supply a portfolio tracker, which essentially is a Google Doc. So that it's with you all the time. It's on your smartphone, it's on your computer, so that whenever anyone asks you these questions, whether it be your financier or accountant, it is there with you. You don't have to go home and then email it. It is there with you. That way you can stay on top of things. The other thing which we find is really, really important and that most people miss is dates and the dates when things expire, such as in today's...
Insurance
is huge. Yeah, there's a client that we have around Christmas every year, about 3 or 4 of their policies start to lapse and we need to chase them.
With this person,
Mr. Tarrant,
in the media.
That's right. Well, actually, what were you called the other day on Fox, Mr. Tarrant?
Mr. Tarrant.
Tarrant.
Yeah, it's the Italian version of Tarrant.
One of the dates that we often see people missing, and especially in today's market, is when their interest only terms expire. I've sat with a few clients recently where their expiry date is within 6 months, and yeah, they need to giddy up now and start organising going forward.
Because if you're proactive and go back to bank now and say, hey, look, I want to extend my interest-only term for another 3 or 4 years, I'll go...
You've got a greater chance.
Yeah. But if that expires and it reverts straight to a
P&I
it's
at a higher rate.
At a higher rate.
Correct. This is where people don't take responsibility for their own investment. These
that's
sorts
your broker's
of
job, isn't it?
Potentially, but it's your job. It's your asset. It's your life. It's your money. It's your call. I think if people took a bigger responsibility, they'd be in a far better financial position. So a year out is when you should start looking at these things. When does your lease expire, as an example, and giving 2 months' notice whether the tenant should go or increase the rent or re-sign them, whatever it may be. When does your insurance, as we talked about a little earlier on, what's the current rates?
Yeah, I'm quite cyclical in my attention to detail in our portfolio. And we haven't got a massive portfolio, but it's not a small portfolio, right? There's quite a lot of moving parts.
Yeah.
Properties all over Australia and... you know, et cetera, et cetera. But I know that when I start to feel a little bit less connected with my portfolio, which I do right now, Victor, by the way, and you've just prompted me to sort some stuff out, right? I know it's quite quick to be able to get reconnected with my portfolio. If I spend half a day, I could sort it out, right? You know, I can tweak all those things out. I'm back into it. I know what's going on. I know there's any pressure points. I know whatever. And the way I manage my portfolio, I've got someone I work quite closely with here who, you know, got a system for telling me when there's problems. I don't know, Victor, you manage your portfolio a very similar way. You're not the guy who's making sure bills and stuff are paid. Someone does that for you. But you've got a relationship with someone who knows what information you need in order for you to be connected with your portfolio.
Yeah.
And that works for you.
That does. And one of the things that you'll find is a good property portfolio, it's really easy to lose connection with it because it doesn't feel like a cash flow drain.
Mm.
And when it is not a cash flow drain, you tend not to focus on it. But it's only when it starts hurting that most people refocus on their portfolio, and by that time it's too late.
That's we often say, if you're not feeling it, it's dangerous. Because if you're not feeling it, as you just said, Vic, well, it's out of sight, out of mind. But if you were having to skimp around and scrounge around for every dollar, well, then you'd be well on top of your portfolio. And unfortunately, you're often a victim of your own good portfolio.
Well, this is it, you know, and again, I purchased a property probably a month or so ago. Oh, it was probably 2 months ago. You guys helped me out with it up in Kallinga. And it needed a bit of work done to it. And, you know, I think the mortgage on it is like $1,300 a month or something or other. And I went, I've got to get this sorted out. But I was doing so many other things that sat there and probably didn't work as fast as it should have done for me to get to a point where I could get rented out, which has just happened now. So I probably carried that property for 2 months now without any income on it. And I actually went, $1,300, that hurts a bit, but it didn't hurt so much that I jumped to it really, really quickly, and that's a
but you would have
my
that's
not good. That's not good on my behalf, you know. And that should have been a really big signal to me to sort this stuff out. I think I eventually went, shit, I've got to sort this out. This is actually starting to hurt a bit, right? So it was a really good motivator to keep it on. So how do you strike that balance though? Because I know in business, I work the best when I'm under the pump, right?
Well, this is it, right? And that's it. Because we're all in business and we've all got property portfolios, often when you've got deadlines and you need to achieve stuff, that's when your best results, that's when your best work happens. But when things are percolating, they're ticking over, well, it's it is out of sight. You become complacent.
Cruise mode.
And that's what and that's what our scope is. That's what our job is with our clients. You know, we regularly do reviews on them. We like to do them every quarter in a perfect world where we sit down and we go through the numbers, we tweak the portfolio on what we should do now, 3 months, 6 months, 12 months, so that we're adjusting the cash flow, we're adjusting their timing, but it also gives us very clear direction on what, when and where it should be next. So whether that be consolidating, whether that be buying again in 12 months, or what actions we need to do now to, let's say, perhaps release equity in 6 months. What are we going to do now to get that result in 6 months? How do we adjust serviceability by perhaps using some of the equity to pay out a car loan? Speak to your broker though and your financial advisor so that your serviceability is a little more enhanced, or put rents up, whatever it may be. But if you're not connected to your portfolio, as you put it, that closely, it's not just the now that's hurting you, it's actually what's going to happen in 6 months. It's what's going to happen in 12 months.
And things can snowball quickly.
Very quickly, very quickly. And if you go back to the worst time that any of us have experienced, which would be the GFC, and I don't know of anybody that really lost their portfolios or any property from a lack of
negative equity.
It was from a lack of cash flow.
Yeah.
And that's why it's so important. We often talk about controlling your cash flow is about the next important thing behind oxygen. You just need it.
This might be a bit of a generalization, but imagine you guys work with investors right across Australia. And over the years that I've worked with you guys, you know, we sort of anecdotally spoke about the type of people, you know, like engineers are a particular sort of beast, and then you might be doing work with doctors who see the world a little bit differently. So people are all wired slightly different, right? But if I was going to generalize, you would probably have people who are mad property investors who are every single day living and breathing property. And then you've got people who I would probably fall more into the boat of just someone that wants to create wealth through property and sort of just expects it to happen
in the background.
In the background them, right? So you've got two very different types of people. In your experience working with your clients, Victor, maybe one for you, do most people, because they use a buyer's agent, are typically got their shit in order? Or do you find that, how do you have those tough conversations with people going,
hey, mate, it comes back to what the systems and procedures the buyers and the property strategies brings to the table, right? If it's just, you want a property and here's a property and off you go, then that's different, right? So what I find is that most people that are investing, they tend to defer to their accountant. And so the only time they're really looking at their portfolio is during tax time. And of course, the accountant then says, depending on when they've bought it, that you've got this much depreciation on it. So your property is actually costing you X or Y. And it's always sugar-coated in terms of tax and depreciation and what add-backs they've been able to get. But if you manage the portfolio based on how we help our clients manage, and in the same way we manage our portfolio, it is spending a little bit of time on a regular basis. It doesn't have to be all life-consuming and that's all you do. A little bit of scheduled time, whether it's weekly, fortnightly, monthly, I wouldn't go beyond a month to see, first of all, whether all your properties are rented. If you're getting the rent that's quoted on the statement as the net rent that's coming to your account, it has actually dropped into your account. And whether there's some simple stuff as you've been invoiced for something twice. So you actually need to look at the statements. You need to look at all the paperwork that comes across to you.
Reconciliation. At the end of the day. And I think that's where people...
That's where they fall down. Boring stuff, though, isn't it?
It's an hour a month. You know? Like, that's all it takes. So I sat with someone yesterday that's got 21 properties. They spend literally an hour a month entering the data into their portfolio trackers that we supply. And that's all it takes. But if you miss 1 month, then it's probably a week's worth.
So let's have a chat about this person, 21 properties. I don't know who they are, but that's how they manage their portfolio, and that's sufficient enough for them to realize their investment goals for investing.
That hour a month is enough for data entry.
That's just data entry.
Yeah.
Okay. So how much other time would this person spend on managing their portfolio in inverted commas?
It's, you know what, it's funny because things go in cycles. You know, you might have a heavy couple of months on maintenance, but you may not have had anything for 3 years, or you might have a lot of vacancies in one hit. So there's no real standard time, but I would assume if I, and knowing them, I would suggest they'd spend probably 10 hours a month between emails, phone calls. Yeah, when you've got 21 properties, 10 hours a month is not much in the scheme of things.
It's a pretty good hourly rate, right? If you think about, you've got 21 properties, what value is that going up every single month divided by your time? It's probably the highest hourly rate you're ever going to get.
Better than McDonald's.
Better than McDonald's.
They're what I would call a sophisticated investor. They are fully dialed in to their position. They live it, they breathe it, as well as holding down two full-time jobs. Yeah, they just, and they enjoy it. That's the key.
Yeah.
Yeah. But then there are a lot of people that have one property or two properties that are just as dialed in, but they obviously don't need as much time. And then there's property investors that just absolutely forget about everything. And at the end of the day, it'll be what it'll be. And that's dangerous.
So let's flip this on the head. We're talking about how much time you should spend investing in property. Investing your time in managing your property. Do you think some people overinvest their time in managing? Like if you've got one or two properties, you know, can you spend too much? Can you overthink your portfolio too much?
I think you can overthink very easily. A lot of that overthinking is usually done before you buy the property. So, you know, analysis paralysis, as we all know about, but you spend so much time researching an area and then running the numbers, which is all good. That's sort of, you know, the tick, 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 the ABC of what you should do right. But then once you've settled the property and you've got a few rent checks or a few paydays and paid the mortgage, it just sort of dwithers away into the back of your mind, into the back of your life, until you want to reinvest again, and then you start to get this. You
know, or if there's an issue that comes up.
Or if an issue comes up. And this is the problem. I truly believe that too many people are reactive to the situation rather than being proactive. And I go back to your accountant comment earlier on. Yeah, most accountants are a reactive scenario. You're there to do your tax at the end of the financial year, and what can we do rather than what can we do for next year? And very much the same with property.
What should your accountant be doing, a good accountant be doing, to help you manage your portfolio more effectively?
I think it's the other way around. What should you be doing to help yourself with the accountant services? Mm-hmm. So really what you should be doing is, if you're serious about property investing, is, you know, at least have one or two meetings during the financial year with the accountant to see how you're tracking and what you can do to further enhance your portfolio, and also look at fine-tuning things so that, you know, you're doing some tax planning along the way and you are programming your acquisition or consolidation depending on what your tax situation is, what your family situation is, and in fact what your goals are. And the accountant can help you with that along with your broker, along with your strategy. So one of the things we do for clients that are that hold multiple property portfolios, we have a roundtable meeting with their accountant and their broker along with us, so that we are all on the same page. Because like you said earlier, they're all different moving parts, and we want to be making sure they're all moving in the same direction and not pulling against each other, so that the accountant's totally focused on tax minimization, whereas the broker can't get you a loan because you've got aggressive tax minimization happening. So all of those things need to work hand in hand.
They all need to work together. And I've seen it many times where a lot of property investors own their own business. That might be a sole trader or in a partnership or a PTY, whatever it is, right? And their accountant will look to minimize their tax as much as possible so they don't show any income, right? When you take that to your mortgage broker to say, I'd like to get some money, they go, you make it a loss.
Yeah,
you know?
Pay some tax, buddy.
No, it's not really like that. You know, it's so important in terms of managing your portfolio that the different pillars talk to each other to actually understand what the strategy is. It's okay to make a profit if
It's okay to pay tax.
It's good to pay tax.
That's what pays for your infrastructure at the end of the day. Like, you can't have it both ways. And I think that's, once again, that's if you're just starting the journey, so to speak, you need to get together with a broker and with an accountant and with a strategist, if that be the case, and hash out that plan and hash out the goals over what's going to be for you for the next 6 and 12 months. And those that have already got a portfolio, and especially in today's market being driven by finances, we talked about earlier on, now is the time to get on top of your scenario if you're already not, because you know, there may be some pretty good opportunities that come up over the next 6 to 12 months. And if the worst case scenario it isn't, and you've prepared yourself with some liquidity, well then happy days. If that's your biggest problem, that you've got too much liquidity and you haven't spent it, well,
deal with that.
Yeah.
The time taken to effectively manage your portfolio is going to depend on where you are within a cycle.
Correct.
Whether you're accumulating property or you're paying down debt or whatever. So you're probably going to say, Victor, to this question, it depends. But is there a magic equation? So if you're paying a accountant to manage the tax component of your property, if you're using a buyer's agent to help you or a strategist to help you understand your portfolio in a direction, is there a magic equation that says this is how much money you should spend on managing your portfolio based on the size of it or where it is within a cycle? Is that just an impossible thing to sort out?
It would be an impossible thing to sort out. Yeah. So it'll depend on the type of property, the temperament of the investor to begin with. Whether you're a serial renovator where you want to renovate something even though it doesn't need renovation.
Does that happen?
Yeah, it does happen quite a bit. Yeah, all the time.
People watch the block and go, I'm going to renovate.
Yeah, absolutely.
I think the easiest way to manage it really is what I do is I get all of my rentals regardless of entities, and the accountants hate this, right? All of the rentals regardless of entity dropping into the one bank account. And all of my direct debits starting from the bank account as well, right? So I know very quickly if there isn't enough money in there, which means that, hang on, there's something wrong. One of the tenants hasn't paid, or I've got several repairs. So if I've not got the finger on the pulse, that's a really fail-safe way of getting some warning signals. It does not still take away from the fact that you do need to look at the finer details, but it's an easy way to manage it in that sense.
So has there been a time, and you've been investing in property for quite some time, but if you look retrospectively on the building of your portfolio, has there been a time where you've sort of perhaps let it go too far through not managing it effectively and paid penalty for it or consequence of it, whether it's a missed opportunity cost or a financing issue?
In the early years, yeah, absolutely, because we all get gung-ho and think that property investing is all about buying properties. It's about buying well and managing the properties itself. So yes, you do get swayed that way. And especially when the portfolio started getting a little bit bigger, when the brokers that I was using would ask for paperwork, and it'll take you 2-3 weeks to get all the paperwork together.
I've been there.
Yeah. I remember those days, right?
and as we've come a full circle, right? So if you're applying for a loan right now, most banks would want for all of your facilities, if you've got a sizable portfolio, they'll want for all of your facilities at least 4 to 6 months worth of statements, right? Now, if you haven't got all of your paperwork in order, that's going to take you quite a few weeks.
I'm doing that right now. Yeah. And it's a nightmare. It's a headache.
But that's why I'm a fan of this paperless scenario, scenarios or environments. And I mentioned earlier on about portfolio trackers on Google Drive. All of my statements are in there. Everything is in there in case of the scenario that you're in right now, Phil, where the broker's saying, give me this, this, and this. Unless you're at home or within the office, you're not going to be able to do it. Whereas on the road or flying around, we can.
Always being prepared, right? And that's what makes on top a of good stuff. Investor.
Absolutely.
But is there certain sort of pressure points as you grow as a property investor the number of properties you acquire, and we won't go into that, but just the absolute size. So if you go between, once you get the 5 properties, does it start getting into a different realm of headache or possible? So what are those points you reckon?
You know, property one, that's the hardest because it's all new.
It's the new baby, right?
And you're getting used to it and you're listening to everybody else on how they do it, and you just got to find your own groove. Property two gets easy. I reckon the next magical milestone in terms of everything, so I'm talking finance, management, headspace, pressure, is around about that 5 mark. Now, I'm just taking an average purchase price here. We're not talking about 5 $1 million properties, just your average purchase price.
Yeah.
I think 5's that magic milestone.
Is that where we could all come unraveled if you don't get that right? Get past the 5,
I think it can come unraveled number one.
Yeah.
Yeah. You need to start as you mean to continue. Does that make sense?
Absolutely.
Yeah, you're right. It
makes sense.
Because if you don't, you'll create bad habits.
So how do you keep the energy that you had property number one all the way through to property number 20, 30, 50?
Pretty easy, I suppose. You're just focusing on a goal. So if you've got your goal sorted out, the energy's there, right? If you're just investing for the sake of investing, yes, it becomes sort of a thing that you're doing in the background, and therefore you'd lose sight of the detail, you lose sight of the reason as to why you're investing.
For me, I'm a bit, I agree with Vic, the goals are a very, very big part of it, but the goals are always changing for me, especially with as your family grows. So for me, it's about the instant gratification. And I think we've talked about this before, property is often one of these asset vehicles that you can't get instant gratification. So I look back retrospectively and I look at what my portfolio has done for me over the last year, then I break it down to a month, down to a year, down to a day, down to an hour, down to a minute, down to a second. And I know that's a little bit creepy and it's a little bit over the top.
How much money do you make every second, Steve? Come on. Remember, there used to be that calculator that went around and said Rupert Murdoch made this much money in this much time.
Look, some of it's subjective, obviously, because you're only giving your own valuations on your own portfolio. But I think for me to keep the energy, we're very, I suppose, privileged that we surround ourselves with people that are doers. And when you surround yourself with those people and vice versa, you ride off each other's energies and results, and it's a very, very good environment to be in.
Well, one of the things, I know we do it occasionally where we'll look at our portfolio and I'll go, X property here, Steve, what do you think the valuation is?
Right.
I really enjoy it, like the valuation game, right? Like, what's it worth? And generally we're really good because when we get a bank val against the sort of deemed val, and that's obviously through some science and comparable properties and stuff, and the fact that you're in the market all the time. I really enjoy doing that.
It's good fun, right?
Oh, really? Is that going? You reckon it's gone up that much?
Yeah. It's good fun.
It's good fun.
Yeah.
But it's a nice fun bit about managing your properties. Making money, right?
Well, it is. But you can't do it every day because you won't feel that, it's gone up $1,000 this week.
You start fudging the numbers too.
Well, you do. And I think you've got to be real. Otherwise, you'll be in for a big
letdown. Well, you always are on the side of conservative.
Yeah, but I am conservative.
I reckon that's even higher than that.
I'm the negative one, It's good.
That's all right. So managing your property, I think we've done that pretty reasonable sort of justice.
Mm.
Victor, summarise it for me in 3 points.
In 3 points.
How do you be...
Don't steal my points, though.
What are the three pillars to being good at managing your property?
Don't lose sight of the numbers.
Yep.
Don't lose sight of the reason why you started investing, and keep reevaluating your goals and making sure that you are looking at your at the paperwork on a regular basis.
All right. Very succinct, Steve. Can you do better than that?
Don't steal my points now.
The pressure. Be involved, be real, and be prepared.
Ooh, there you go.
Yeah, that's a Girl Scout thing, isn't it?
I know. You
got 20 cents in your pocket there? I don't have any
money.
You got
all my money.
Yeah. I'm going to go back to the way I summarise it. You got to be connected with your portfolio, right?
Always.
And I ebb and flow, and I think everyone does. We're humans. Life catches up with you sometimes, but you need to find a mechanism to somehow shake yourself to make sure you get back in and get involved. And Victor, you've prompted me to go and sort of hassle some people this afternoon, going, what's going on with this? What's going on with that? Let's have a look at rentals and stuff like that. But I actually get a lot of satisfaction about being organized. I'm a bit weird like that, right? And if I feel things are sort of drifting away from me, if I can grab it and pull it back and feel organized, I get a lot of satisfaction out of that.
Mm.
Makes me feel good. So works for me. Good.
Works for me.
So we're nearing the end of the first series of the Investing Insights with the Right Property Group. I think we've got two more
to go.
Mm-hmm. Two more things. And we're thinking about something really creative for one of the final ones. And we'll make sure that we let everyone know what we're going to do in that regards. But I think we're talking about doing a bit of a Q&A session because we've been at this now. This is, I think, the 10th episode of this particular series. And I know the questions have been flooding in, Victor. So I don't want people to feel frustrated that they've been emailing us and we haven't got back to them. We have collected them and the team have really sort of synthesized all different questions. So we're going to look to do a Q&A session. So if you don't yet or you haven't yet emailed the guys questions at rightpropertygroup.com.au about absolutely anything, please do so because we want to get some of the questions are quite similar. There's some common themes that keep appearing, but please do write in and let us know what you'd like to have a chat about and we'll have some good fun. We'll do a bit of an extended episode. Does that work for you, Victor?
Looking forward to it.
Do you guys want to add anything before we sign off?
I don't know. Get your stuff together. You got a property to buy.
Yeah. Keep buying. It's good. Thanks for joining us, everyone. We do appreciate it. Remember to check out rightpropertygroup.com.au if you want to know any more information about the guys. I've been to some of these as well. You still doing your Tuesday night?
Yep. Once a month at Parramatta Ridges.
Yeah, once a month in Parramatta Ridges, and you can see that on our Facebook page or the website, and then once a month in Melbourne as well.
Do you have to register for those or you just rock up?
Yeah. But go to the Facebook page or the website, and it'll show you how to do that.
Okay. But no, they're good. I've been on there. They're good. Yeah. Outside of listening to you guys drone on.
I know, right?
What I like about it is a lot of really, really good investors there who are pretty much the people we described today. They're from all walks of life, right?
Yeah.
From people who are passionate investors, some people who are new, or some people who are sort of whatever type people. So
And it is a safe space. Yeah. Like, we don't allow developers or sort of marketing companies or anyone flogging their stuff in there. It's an open forum. We're pretty relaxed and We get up and we have different subjects. We'll talk about it and just throw questions at us all night or to the panel that we may have up there.
Yeah, it's good fun.
Yeah, it's good.
Meet some like-minded people. Thanks for coming, guys. Appreciate it.
Thanks, mate.
Thank you.
We'll be back again next month. See ya. Bye.
The information featured in this podcast is general in nature and does not take into consideration your financial situation or individual needs and should not be relied upon. Before making any investment, insurance, tax, property, or financial planning decision, you should consult a licensed professional who can advise whether your decision is appropriate for you. Guests appearing on this podcast may have a commercial relationship with the companies mentioned.